Come, God, come walk with your people. For you alone are our strength and glory, and we put our trust in you. Come, God, come walk behind us, beside us, before us. For you alone are our shelter and direction, and we put our trust in you. Come, God, come seek and find and put us right. For you alone are the light in our darkness, and we put our trust in you. Come, God, we know you are near. The sound of your footsteps sets us dancing. Help us to praise and worship you.
Please be seated. On the 5th of May 1939, the outbreak of a Second World War was just a few months away. A small group of men was meeting in London. W.H. Aldous was among them. They were meeting because among evangelicals there was a growing sense of urgency for establishing a Bible school in London. These men prayed and they planned. The war meant the plans were slowed, but in the autumn of 1943, as the war raged, evening classes began. In the near three quarters of a century since LBC, now LST, since then, this organisation has become a leader in evangelical higher education and theological research. One could conjure with the names of the influential academics like Mary Evans and Dick France, who have taught and conducted their research here. And one stands in awe of the ways the 7,000 and more graduates have served the body of Christ across the globe. Our second principal, Gilbert Kirby, said this: "We dare to believe that in the years to come, some of the outstanding Christian leaders in Asia, in Africa, in Latin America, and in many other areas of the world will in fact be men and women who took their training at LBC." He was right. For example, an LST graduate is principal of Colombo Theological Seminary, and another is director of the Ethiopian Graduate School of Theology. Our grads are in the House of Commons and in the House of Lords. Professors and bishops are among those 7,000 plus grads, and so are the founders of Greenbelt, Spring Harvest, and New Frontiers. More importantly, there are literally thousands of Christians working in churches and in the marketplace who are transforming their places of work, helping people meet Jesus because they have been equipped at LST. And what has been accomplished here has depended on key people. LST depends on many of you, its friends, for its practical and prayerful support. It depends on its faculty engaging the minds of the students and mentoring them to success. It depends on the administrative staff to provide strong structures and systems, and the food and the library books. And LST depends on its key leader. 3 weeks ago, Calvin T. Samuel walked through the door to become our next principal. I thank God, and I thank the Board of Governors for the appointment of this man. And when you get to know Calvin, I think you'll do the same. I'm so glad then that you've joined us for his induction. We want to pray for Calvin, to ask God to fill and empower him with the Holy Spirit. We want to give public voice to our commitment to pray for him, to encourage him, and to support him. So welcome. Thank you for sharing in this defining moment.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Praise the Lord, you that are his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, now and forever. From the rising of the sun to its setting, may the Lord's name be praised.
Redeemed people of God, would you stand and celebrate this amazing love? The one who the Son has set free is free indeed. Would you worship with us today? Sing this out. This is amazing grace. Lift your voices. This is unfailing love. Would you take my place? That you would take my place. Lift your voices,
worthy is the King who conquers.
This is all about you, Jesus,
worthy is the Lamb who says
that you be glorified at LST. That you be glorified in this new moment. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Sing it out. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King. Just the voice is worthy.
Dr. Samuel, we welcome you today to the community of London School of Theology. Please take a moment and share with us how your journey has brought you to be with us today.
Thank you, Stephanie. It's a real joy to be with you. It's also a real surprise to be with you. The trajectory that we imagined for ourselves as Ramona and I reflected on the future was not this one. But in many ways, I've been in preparation for this role for the last 25 years or so. I'm a product of an institution very much like this one, rooted in evangelical tradition, committed to scholarship, committed to the church, and committed to God's world. I came from Antigua to train for what I believed was pastoral ministry back in the Caribbean, and arrived in sunny Manchester in 1993. When I say it was sunny, what I mean is, it wasn't. I came full of trepidation, unsure of my academic ability, unsure that I was cut out for this kind of thing, unsure that I was worthy to be in a place like that. And what I discovered very quickly is, number one, I was right. I was unworthy, I am unworthy. But I discovered, number two, God knows that and really doesn't give a toss. It is because we recognize that we are unworthy that God is able to use us. And so there I was, in Manchester, and I discovered a sense of call to theological education. And even then, I began to realize that my trajectory that I imagined for myself of returning to the Caribbean, of exercising pastoral ministry there, ideally somewhere in close proximity to one of our 365 beaches, that's what I hoped for. Instead, God called me to offer to others the experience that I received, of being affirming to those who think they are unworthy and saying, yes, you are right, you are. But we serve a God who recognizes that and loves us despite our unworthiness and our shortcomings and equips us for all that God calls us to do. And so in many ways, that is the short version of my call to this place, feeling as I did 23 years ago, unworthy to be in this place, unworthy to stand in this wonderful tradition, unworthy to be amongst you. And as I think that, I again hear the Spirit saying, yes, you're right, you are not. But I still don't give a toss about that, because God calls unworthy people like us to serve him and to offer who we are, meager gifts as it is, to be used for his kingdom and his glory. So it is a delight to be among you tonight, a delight to be in this place and to stand in that tradition of which we heard a little earlier in this service, and to invite you with me to celebrate our unworthiness and to celebrate the God who calls us despite our shortcomings, to offer our meager gift. Because I want to finish with this. One of my favorite stories is of the feeding of the 5,000, of the disciples discovering that they have 5 loaves and a few fish, but saying, what good is that when we have so many? That story is a reminder when we look at ourselves and see our meager gifts and think, what good is that? That story reminds us of a Jesus who is able to take what we offer, to break it, to multiply it, and to enable it to be a blessing to far more people than we could ever imagine. That is who we are. And I'm delighted to share in that journey with you. Thank you.
As Viva Voce returned to the front, I'm going to be a bit cheeky and bring some greetings to Dr. Calvin Samuel from not only the Methodist Church in the London district, where you're very welcome, that we're glad you've come home to this home. We have less beaches, but we do our best. But also from the Methodist Council that meets today in Milton Keynes. A number of people send their very warm wishes to you, Calvin, on this occasion. And now we will sing, led first of all by Viva Voce, God Has Chosen Us.
Please take your seats. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And God has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As God's fellow workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain. For he says, "In the time of my favor, I heard you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation."
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I cannot begin to tell you how privileged I am to have been asked to address you tonight for a number of reasons, but principally it's always nice to have a great excuse to be back in the territory of LST, and this is as good an excuse as it gets. They are moving. I was hoping to preach to Calvin's back. And that's partly because a part of the opportunity I had over the last 4 years as a student under Calvin's leadership at St. John's has been from time to time to be in one of the student feedback tutorial session which Calvin facilitates. I have to say, the best description might be as a kind of a benign interrogator. So it's quite dangerous for him to ask me to speak. And the last thing to say is that I never did actually tell you, Dr. Samuel, that I was privileged to be a referee for your application, it was the first time in my life that two people have actually asked me to be their referee for the same job. It was quite amusing. So when I heard you got the job, I wondered if I sent the wrong application. I'm pretty sure it was okay. There are those moments in Scripture where one experiences something of an in-flight moment. It feels to me that the passage we just had read begins with one of those in-flight moments. All this is from God who reconciled himself to us, and so on. But in typical form, Paul ambles up to the trampoline, to the springboard, to take in flight. Begins, I guess, in a kind of a majestic rhythm in the middle of chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians. Love of Christ constrains us, he says. One died for all, therefore all died. And if he died for all, he died that those who live may no longer live to themselves, but to him who died and was raised again. If we used to think of Christ in earthly terms, we no longer think of him like that. And if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has begun. The old things are past, the new has come. All of this is from God. So if I had a chance to start to get my own back for Dr. Samuel's tutorials and the comments he's made about my performances over the last few years, it's maybe just to take this as an opportunity to give what I think is a kind of an insight in what a Bible college is all about. I've been thinking about this very, very, very deeply for a very long time, about 2 weeks or so. So I want you to distill my thoughts back to you. And something of a college for ambassadors. It seems to me that any theological or Bible teaching institute which misses the heart of this text misses the reasons for Greek declensions, grades which go up and down, marking the homework, examinations. All of us who have anything to do with theological education are called to this stupendous task of reconciliation. And therefore, all the graft, all the hard work, all the headaches, all the marking of papers, all the graduation ceremonies, all the induction services add up to one thing. God has called us to be ambassadors. It strikes me that Greek declensions become that bit harder if you don't get that. And therefore, I wonder if a role of those of us in theological education and principally the principal has this humongous task of coordinating human effort to conspire with God to be a part of this incredible and very exciting journey and enterprise. And Bible colleges should therefore retain something of the immensity of the Reformation idea that the plowboy and the Bible are to be believed against even a bishop without it. God has called us to this amazing role of being ambassadors. And I like the thought of the mandate for an ambassador. God has reconciled us to himself through Christ and given us the ministry of reconciliation. I remember being in Jamaica a few years ago, and every time I mention Jamaica in public, I have a kind of a moral responsibility to tell you that Jamaica is where God has his official residence on the planet. He turns up in one or two other places, but that's where he actually lives on earth. And when I was in this visit to Jamaica, I remember talking to a whole bunch of very dispersed and very different ministers. Some of them actually hadn't spoken to each other ever, even though they were quite close to each other. So I went down, courtesy of the High Commission of Jamaica here, to meet with a number of Jamaican leaders, and I wanted to bring them all together. I was talking to the ambassador, the UK ambassador to Jamaica. And I said, I've got this idea, I'd love to meet all of my colleagues. Wouldn't it be great if you could invite them for me? And he did. When the ambassador called them, they all showed up. This task of reconciliation, this task of the ambassador, has this amazing challenge and privilege of calling people from diverse backgrounds to meet in the presence of God's reconciling agenda. There really isn't a higher calling. And this high calling hangs at a very low place because everybody and anybody who has been touched by the life of Christ and who have been constrained by the love of Jesus is called to this task. And therefore, the task of the ambassador and the reason we train you and the reason we induct principals is not to fight cultural wars with the world, but to see people released from us who have this proclivity to bring people together with God and to God. I am fascinated by the fact that so often in Christian world we are about power, about who has the upper hand. But really, it's the task of bringing together diversity. I remember when I was here in 1972 for 3 years, the then principal of London Bible College, as it was then, Gilbert Kirby, was a great ambassador himself. He said many very helpful things to us. One of those I remember well was, in heaven, there'll be two words, hallelujah and Coca-Cola. I don't think he was serious. But the other thing he once said to us was this, look, if, there was a slow ripple, if you come to this place, he said, if you are a Methodist or an Anglican or a Baptist or a Pentecostal, we don't expect you to become something else when you leave. It was one of the joys of being in an interdenominational place. And it was true. We had our fierce arguments. We had our theological discussions. But actually, on the whole, we left pretty much as we came. And here's a secret. Possibly understanding our own faith even better. The role of the ambassador is to bring diversity together. Here's the second thing which fascinates me about this role of the ambassador and the task of reconciliation, is that it has a win-back effect. That's why you've got the win-back theme attached to my talk. Now might be the wrong time to refer to British Telecom as the centerpiece of your sermon, given the troubles they're having. But it just demonstrates that I prepared this sermon before yesterday, and this guy is not for turning. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sin against them, and has committed to us this message of reconciliation. The very fact of reconciliation, the very task of reconciliation presupposes something rather mysterious, rather glorious, perhaps even rather dangerous, that somewhere in our corporate relationship with God, we were once all together with God, and we have gone in different ways. And reconciliation only makes sense theologically if somewhere we harbor the idea that God wants to regroup and recoup and recover humanity in its totality. Karl Barth wrestled with this idea of Christian universalism. I was in the library in St. John's not long ago on another project I'm working on and stumbled across this wonderful text from Karl Barth. I thought I would mention the library just to encourage students that it's probably sometimes worth attending. He makes a distinction between what he called the called and the uncalled. And he's grappling with this idea of a Christian universalism. But they, says Barth, talking about the people of God in the Old Testament, could not proceed on the assumption that the world and humanity around them were unaffected by the work of the Word of God, but in faith in his work and the Word of God, they, the people of God, assumed that they were already affected by them. So they, the people of God, could not let them continue to think of themselves as the uncalled, but rather to question, to attack, to shatter this understanding by addressing and treating them as though they were really and directly already called. Well, I think he means, in my language, treat people as though God wants them back. And if we do that, we have the ingredients for a win-back kind of ministry. Here's the secret of a win-back ministry. A win-back ministry seeks to reconcile, not score points. A win-back ministry doesn't necessarily talk about people leaving Islam or leaving Hinduism or coming from sin, but is much more concerned about people coming to God. A win-back ministry isn't scoring points. I have to confess that sometimes I get just a little jittery in the company of some evangelical friends and in some churches. Hey, one hears a kind of vitriolic approach to evangelism and Christian witness. I was that, now I'm this. And there's a kind of a scalping, a kind of a point scoring approach to our witness about Jesus Christ. I constantly say to folks, look, God didn't call us to pull down Muhammad, but to lift up Jesus Christ. And therefore, win-back ministry is committed to a ministry of appealing. We appeal to you, says Paul. It's not a demand. And there are those times, and especially in the context and the culture in which we find ourselves, where admittedly Christian faith is now having to share space with other spiritualities. We're having to learn to share space with secular mindsets. We're having to learn to share space in places of influence which we didn't 30 or 20 years ago. And I do get just a little concerned when I hear a kind of passionate, aggression about our ministry in the world. No, a win-back kind of ambassadorial reconciling ministry makes an appeal to the world, not a demand. There's a book I haven't written yet, and if you write it before me, I will know that you have plagiarized my title. But it's called Permission to Speak. I'm fascinated that when one looks through the scriptures and you see where the people of God presents the message of God, it is invariably in response to a question, an invitation to present Christ. What must we do to be saved? Ah, let me tell you. What do these things mean? Asked the crowd. Ah, let me explain. And it is no coincidence that the very first Christian sermon Peter preached was as a direct response to a question. Paul stepped into a synagogue on one occasion, and the elders said to him, "Ah, Paul, if you have any words of encouragement, you may now speak." That's a great prelude for the average sermon, I dare to suggest. So the win-back ministry works like this. One day many years ago, after my wife and I no longer felt that we needed the service of British Telecom, our phone rang. And a woman on the end of the other phone, on the end of the line, said, "Hello, Mr. Edwards." "Yes, Mr. Edwards." "Ah, I am," let's call her Jennifer. "I am Jennifer from BT's Win Back team." I thought, how amazing. They had a whole department set up to win you back. And did she come with offensive statements? Not on this occasion. Did she come with intolerance and impatience? She did not. It was entreating. "Why did you leave us? Is there something better we could have done? Can I offer you a better deal than the one you had before?" We are fairly impervious to those things, my wife and myself. So the answer was no. But the invitation was unmistakable. And ambassadors are called to be win-back people. We release people from institutions like these not to pontificate to the world or be morally superior, but to be reconcilers, bringing people back to God. And we do it without compromising the content and the character of the gospel we preach. Yet, this message is all about atonement, not self-actualization. Here in the entreaty, here in the invitational culture we perpetrate on the world, is a 2,000-year commitment to the cross of Jesus Christ, which is gracious in its lack of compromising. And it carefully balances entreaty with a clear message. Because here is what the message is about. God made him who had no sin to become sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This, ladies and gentlemen, is about win back courtesy of the cross. Even when it is inconvenient, even when it goes against the cultural grain, even when it seems intolerant or impatient with our culture and even with friends of other faiths, that this win-back message does not compromise the substance and the power and the unique nature of the gospel we preach. And yes, it is a deep and mysterious and bewildering message. How is it possible that God made him who had no sin to be sin for us in order that we may become God's expression of righteousness. And our problem, of course, and you will do it, students, because it's part of what we are supposed to do as people learning theology. We wrestle with the mechanics of the mystery. And yet, at the end of the day, we say, in this win-back ministry committed to the forgiveness of sin, we join with the statement which I love, Murray Harris, in the Expositor's Bible Commentary. These words, he says, are so carefully balanced, it defies final exegetical explanation, dealing as they do with the very heart of the atonement. I love when people who know a lot more about theology than me says that kind of thing. We stand in awe at the mystery of how this works, but in confidence, as ambassadors, we share it with our world. And here's my final point. This win-back ministry is a constant calling because the time is now. It's not surprising in chapter 6 and verses 1 to 2 that Paul deliberately lifts a text from Isaiah 49, which actually speaks of the people of Israel as those whom God will use to reconcile all things to himself. As God's co-workers, we urge you not to receive God's grace in vain, for he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, says Paul, and we close with this, now is the time of God's favor. Now is the day of salvation. Our challenge, finally, is this. This reconciling win-back ministry happens everywhere at every time. And God has called us to be partners in his ministry.
Let us pray. We thank you, God, that you have opened your word to us through scripture and through the preaching of our brother Joel. We pray that you will give us your Spirit's gifts to help us be the ambassadors of Christ that you call us to be. That like ambassadors, we will be obedient to the call to go into your world and share your message of peace and reconciliation. We pray that you will give us the gifts to learn the language of the world, which can feel like a foreign land in which we are strangers, that we might hear better the needs of those we share Christ's love with. We pray that through your Spirit we will be given gifts of courage and patience, gifts to listen carefully, gifts not to berate and to cause pain in people, but to show them by our love and our lives just how fascinating the gospel is, that they might want to be won back into the fully reconciled family of God. We pray these prayers in the knowledge that you hear us. And together, in whatever language or version we choose, we share in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please take a seat. Just before we get to the act of induction, can I, on behalf of the local churches, say how great it is that we're involved in all this. LST, of course, is international. It's networked across virtual reality. You build theological community in all kinds of places, but you're still rooted here in Northwood. And we're glad of that. We're glad of your presence. And on behalf of the denominations and churches who are here, we're very glad that you've involved us in this act of induction, and we want to continue our partnership with you because we believe it's for the good of the church and the kingdom here in Northwood, here in London, and across the world. So thank you for that. Let me explain what happens next. You haven't got all the words of the next bit, but this is the act of induction. Liturgy is performative, it does things, and it's declaratory, it says things. And we are doing both those things. We are formally, by the questions I shall ask and by the words and responses I get, be saying, Calvin, this is your moment to become the principal. There'll be no magic flashing lights or thunderbolts, well, as the Almighty decides otherwise. But there will be that sense that this is the moment we say. And in the order of service, there are bits where we reflect the fact that we're a team together. And that's where you need to be a bit alert as well, please. So I've got three questions at the end of the act of induction, which are to the faculty and staff, to the governing and student bodies, and to the representatives of local churches and anybody else who's around, rabbits, friends and relations. Those questions are questions which I hope you'll respond to loudly when it gets to that bit, because this is about being part of a partnership which we share together. My brothers and sisters, God has gathered us into the fellowship of the universal church. As members together of his body, Christ calls us to minister in his name, and according to our gifts, to be instruments of his love in the church and in the world. Within the fellowship of the church, God raises up theological teachers and educators to equip the people of God to minister, to pursue and extend teaching and learning, and to enrich the church with that wisdom which comes from above. The Reverend Dr. Calvin Samuel has been called to exercise the role of Principal of the London School of Theology, and I invite the Chair of the Board of Governors to call him to this work.
I present the Reverend Dr. Calvin Samuel, whom the Council believe to be called to this work, to be inducted to the office of Principal.
Is he a person of Christian character, well versed in the Holy Scriptures and the doctrines of our faith, with requisite gifts of leadership and teaching ability?
We do so believe.
Calvin, do you believe, so far as in you lies, that God has called you to this office?
I do so believe.
Do you acknowledge and believe the historic Christian faith, uniquely revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds? And will you teach and live that faith in your life here among us?
With the help of God, I will.
Will you lead this institution in developing biblical, theological thinking and practice to the highest levels, in nurturing Christian faith, spiritual gifts, vocational skills, and personal formation, in encouraging creative integration of biblical learning with other disciplines, and in supporting dynamic innovation in Christian research and practice, and in pursuing Christian excellence in all aspects of school life?
With the help of God, I will.
No pressure. Will you promote unity, peace and love in the church and in the world, and especially among those whom you serve?
With the help of God, I will.
Will you work closely with your colleagues in ministry and encourage the gifts of others?
With the help of God, I will.
And will you seek to fashion your own life and that of your household after the pattern of Christ, setting the example of the Good Shepherd always before you, as you minister and live for him.
With the help of God, I will.
Will you, members of the faculty and staff, uphold your new principal in prayer and work creatively with him as a team?
With the help of God, we will.
Will you, members of the governing and student bodies, support your new principal in his calling to lead this institution?
With the help of God, we will.
And will you, representatives of the local churches and community, continue to work with LST and its new principal to further the kingdom of God, both here in Northwest London and further afield?
With the help of God, we will.
Invested in us as trustees, I admit you, Calvin, as our new principal, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
May Almighty God stir up in you the gifts of his grace and sustain you in your ministry. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
At this point, we'd like to pray informally. Those who might want to come forward and lay hands, and if you have a word to pray, a prayer to make, we have a microphone here to hear you. Come and lay hands. This is a dignified but holy scrum.
Father, thank you so much for your gift to us on this morning. Thank you. Come by your Spirit. Bring wisdom. Bring courage. Bring vision. So open his heart that he may reflect the dear Lord Jesus in his life. Thank you for this man. Bless him.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of the gifts and graces you've poured into Calvin and for the rich ministry we've received in the Northeast and now we're released down to London. Lord, we anoint him and bless him for all that's to come and him and his family. Equip them and renew them afresh that they may serve you faithfully in all their ways to glorify your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, we thank you that you, the God of eternity, are the God of now. And we claim from the scriptures we've considered this evening that word now is the time of God's favour. We claim that for the London School of Theology, now in January 2017. But this man whom you have provided for us, for whom we thank you at the helm, now we declare in the name of Jesus is the time of God's favour.
Father, we thank you that we stand at such a time as this. And in this season, we pray that Calvin will know a fresh anointing for the task that you've called him to. That whatever's gone before is a preparation for where he is now. And we pray that he will embrace the new season that you're bringing him into. I pray that you'll give him strong people around him, wisdom, people of wisdom and understanding, so that he might know what needs to be done for such a time as this. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that the leaders that come from this school will transform this nation and the nations of our world because of what you implant and impart into them in this place. Not just academically, but spiritually, to bring about your kingdom and your reconciling good news we've heard about tonight. So anoint him fresh today, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the enduring presence of London School of Theology. I pray that you, the Holy Spirit, might increase wisdom and revelation in Calvin, that in him and in his family, that there might be an increase of love and hope every day, I pray. That your kingdom purposes might be worked out in his life, and that he might be a great team leader for all that you wish through the life of LST. Let your kingdom come and let your will be done, all the more in and through this man, for the praise of Jesus and his joy. Amen.
Let me just pray for Calvin tonight. We pray that all that everyone has declared and decreed upon him, that the grace and the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit may rest afresh upon him. We pray for wisdom, we pray for knowledge, we pray for understanding, we pray for clarity, we pray for direction. We pray that this time at LST will be a time that the LST will move into a new dimension. We pray that this time will be a time that history will be made and many lives will be changed. We pray that even his relationship and communion with the leaders around this community, that his time in this place, many may come to know the Lord and become the follower of Jesus. We pray that during this time, the LST will move into a new dimension because of the grace that will rest upon him, that there will be a deeper relationship with the staff, with the rest of the governors, with the students, that LST will grow from strength to strength. We pray for his family. We pray for his extended relationship. I will just pray today, as hands are laid upon you, may you receive a fresh anointing in the world that God has called. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I thank you for Calvin. I thank you for who he is. But I pray now, Lord, that the burden of this responsibility would feel so light as he journeys this with you. I thank you for that huge promise in Scripture, Lord, that you'll be with us. And would you be with him in the weeks ahead? I thank you, Lord, for the team you've built around him. But we want to pray a big prayer for LST. We want to pray that the future of this institution would be far greater than its past.
Yes,
Lord, we love hearing of the past and all the names and all the stuff, Lord, but we want to dream new dreams.
Yes,
and I want to pray, Lord, that under his inspirational leadership, you would take this place into opportunities it's never had before. I want to pray you would grow leaders that would transform this nation.
Yes,
I want to pray, Lord, that not just within the church, but within the land, within public leadership too, Lord, you would do wonderful things. But I want to pray as well, Lord, I want to pray that LST would make a huge difference in this locality too. Lord, I want to pray that Northwood and the surrounding area would know that there was a Bible college here and would know, Lord, that great things are happening as a result. I want to pray, Lord, the streets of this community would come to know you, because the students pour out of that place, they would pour something of you into the surrounding area. And I pray that Calvin would lead this wonderful college with a clear conviction that the church exists to reach lost people. And I pray that that would happen as a result here and all over the world.
And what we've prayed, we ask, Lord, you will bring to pass. And all God's people said,
Amen.
People of the LST community, I present to you your new principal, please greet him.
We'd like to ask you to join us today in a prayer of intercession for Calvin and for LST as a whole. In the confidence of God's concern for all creation, we offer our prayers for the world and ourselves. We pray for the church, the body of Christ, celebrating our diversity and mourning our brokenness, as our worship tonight is a sign of the unity Christ requires of his people. May we be ready to work together in mission and service. God of grace, hear our prayer. Through our lives and by our prayers, your will be done. We pray for the world created by God, celebrating its diversity and mourning its brokenness. In places of conflict, where prejudice and fear threaten to overwhelm all that is good, may God's spirit of peace inspire us to break down walls of division and build bridges of love. God of grace, hear our prayer. We pray for the London School of Theology, celebrating its diversity and longing for its flourishing. We pray for the faculty, for the administrative and support staff, for the students, and all who share in the life of college. We pray for Calvin, our new principal, that his time in leadership will be a time of growth and grace for him and for the community he has come to serve. God of grace, hear our prayer. Pray for ourselves, celebrating our diversity and seeking for a deepening relationship with God. We pray for openness of hearts, that we might love God more fully. We pray for openness of minds, that we may learn more of God's love for the world. We pray for openness of lives, that we might be the generous, faithful people God calls us to be. God of grace, hear our prayer.
Give us the gifts and graces to fulfill our high calling as disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. First, I have the pleasure to offer some thanks. Today has been a joyous occasion for LST, and I'm sure you can imagine that the organisation and planning involved to create such a wonderful day is immense. I would like to give a special thank you to Rooney for being the coordinator of the day. With collaboration from so many colleagues, she has worked tirelessly and with grace for many weeks. I know it has not been without the odd small challenge, but we have also found time to laugh together during a few moments of shared humour. There has been a real buzz in the LST community today, particularly when there was a fire alarm. And the entire community has played a part today. I would like to thank all of them in their involvement, in particular for the catering team who has created some wonderful culinary delights for us, and most of them are still working hard at LST now. Our facilities, events and estates team have equally worked very hard and seamlessly so that everything comes together. I wish to thank all of you for being here to share this day with us and to offer your support to Calvin. Some of you have travelled for several hours through freezing fog to get here, and some of you may struggle to get home as a result of the tube strike. We are grateful for all your efforts to be here, and we do have some spare duvets.
And of course, I would like to thank those who have been involved in leading our worship here to create such a memorable and special service for us. I would like to share with you two dates of further events in the LST calendar, both of which take place here at Emmanuel Church. LST's Lang Lecture will take place on Monday, the 13th of February at 7:30. The lecture will be given by Ian Proven, who is the Marshall Shepherd Professor of Biblical Studies at Regent College, Vancouver. Ian is an alumnus of LST. The Dea Gloria Lecture this year will be given by Canon Andrew White, more popularly known as the Vicar of Baghdad. This lecture will be on the 7th of March at 7:30. We look forward to seeing many of you at these events. And my final notice is a reminder that you are all very welcome back to LST after this service for a drinks reception. Thank you.
Go in the peace of God the Father.
We have the gospel to proclaim.
Go grow in the love of Christ the Son.
We will journey on with him.
Go in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God.
And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you this day and always. Amen.
Amen.